So, good morning, everybody, and my sincere thanks to the organizers for letting me speak in this conference. I'm not used to talking and reading from a script, being in, you know, in business, but my team said it's too serious a conference to go around the stage and dancing up and down and talk about a subject. So they wrote a script for me. I think all of you belong to the drug safety organization of very reputed companies. So all of you have a very strong view, I think, what I call inside-out view on drug safety. What I try to give, I mean, being in this field, I think I have been probably less than many of you, but I think I get to meet a lot of customers, get to see a lot of technologies, and get to hear a lot of thought leaders and disruptive innovators. I'll try to give you an outside-in view, right? And by no means it's the only view you can have, but I think hopefully I'll put in a few thoughts which will get you to thinking a bit more on the subject. So I think it's well-known fact. I think we are going through the transformation era in healthcare. Healthcare ecosystem across the globe is changing. I think all governments and pretty much everybody is undergoing reforms to make sure that the healthcare is more affordable. I think contributing to, or rather because of that, I think the lifespan of people are increasing, which in turn also, I think we are getting into a lot of chronic diseases, which requires, I think, lifelong disease management, which I think puts a lot of pressure on the drug safety because you have to now look at more from long-term as well as short-term view. I think personalization is a big topic. Outcome is a big topic today. I think those of you who are from pharmaceutical companies, you are doing a tremendous job making personalized medicine a reality. Drug safety, I think, is becoming more and more critical factor to meet these objectives of personalization and outcomes. Regulatory landscape is changing. I think you have to almost change your organization every day because regulatory focus is changing every time you have an audit, new issues come up. And so taking into consideration all these things, what I'll try to do, I'll try to give some outside-in perspective and some big picture on drug safety. I think that's the agenda. I'll talk a little bit about context. I'll talk a little bit about three areas: genomics, information and insights integration, and a drug safety architecture, and touch upon briefly about regulatory direction, and then summarize it by putting it all together. Talk about the context. I think there are three topics in this slide which are more from outside, which is your digital age stakeholder. I think healthcare IT, which is, I think, playing a very big role, especially EMR, and personalized medicine, which I think is changing the way pharmaceuticals are being developed. And I think there are two topics which are very specific to pharmaceutical companies, which is R&D productivity, and the way I think cost pressure and sales environment is shaping up in pharmaceutical companies. So if you talk about digital age customers, I think today, pretty much everybody is in information network, right? Information flows through instantly. Whatever happens in one part of the world is available to the other part of the world instantly. Question, I think, as a drug safety organization and function you have to ask is, how do you use digital as an effective means of interacting with your stakeholder? Take the second topic, EMR. I think pretty much everybody I have interacted with in healthcare space, every hospitals, we do a lot of work in EMR space also. Everybody is talking EMR either in the context of their own healthcare delivery system, or in many cases like in UK and many other countries in the world in a broader context where you are talking about whole country under a single electronic medical record database and so on and so forth. I think that gives you an access to tremendous longitudinal patient data, right, which typically in a drug trial you won't get. Question is, how do you integrate the EMR data into your drug safety analytics? Third topic, which is the personalized medicine, I think it's becoming more and more evident that animal models are not as strong indicator of toxicity as it is in case of human, right? Especially if you take CNS, central nervous systems. I think, I don't think you can compare rat or mouse brain with human brains. I hope not. And that kind of puts it into saying, how do you model humans? So, and you cannot take human into labs for experiments. So I think in silico modeling becomes very important. I think genomics plays a tremendous role there. If you take the two other topics, which is the R&D productivity and the sales environment, I think, I mean, it's a well-known fact, and I think all of you know, I think R&D productivity, I think there is a patent expiry. Productivity of R&D is coming down or has come down. I think there is a lot of pressure to bring new markets, new drugs to the market quickly. And question is, can drug safety collaborate with R&D to improve the R&D productivity and reduce the time to market? I think that's a critical question. And if you take the sales again, because of US healthcare reforms and overall cost pressure, I think demography in the Western countries are very much changing, right? The aging population is putting tremendous pressure on the social systems of almost all countries, irrespective of, you know, I think only a few countries in the world are exceptions. I come from one of them, which is India. Unfortunately for us, we don't even have a strong healthcare system. So it's not putting too much pressure on the government yet. But you go to any, I was in Japan week before last week, I think you talk any countries in the Europe, US, everywhere it's putting pressure, which in turn is putting pressure on the pharmaceutical companies, saying, can you give more for less? Right, which I think many other industries have gone through the problem many years. It's now come to pharmaceutical industry. So can you position drug safety as a differentiator during sales? That's the question, I think, which is internal to the pharmaceutical companies. When you take all of these topics into consideration, and you see each of the social or industry macro trend in turn contributes to changing the way you do drug safety, right? And it's all of them, I think, going to shape the future of drug safety. I think this is the time I feel it's to reimagine, and I interact with a lot of large pharmaceutical companies. All of them are thinking along the lines. I think many of them are taking steps in terms of relooking the way drug safety is done. It's a holistic approach. I think there are lots of information in different databases across the world, and I will talk about a little bit later. I think you need to do a lot of strengthening of your macro, or rather integration foundation. And finally, I think the things are changing almost every day, which probably is not how drug safety organizations of a large pharmaceutical or pharmaceutical company is used to working. I think so, agile and proactive, I think, is another term which has started applying to drug safety quite a bit these days. I think I'll try to take those kind of views into account. I'll talk a little bit more about three areas and then see how you can put all of them together. So these are the areas I'll talk about, a little bit about genomics, little bit about information and insights integration, and talk a little bit about technologies. My team kept on saying I should talk more, lot more about technologies. I said, I don't think that, although that is my sweet spot, that's not what I think makes it outside in view. I think there are a lot of broader changes are happening in science and information, which I think play a bigger role. Technology at the end of the day will continue to be an enabler. Talk about genomics. I think genomics today gives you an way to interrogate living systems at an unprecedented level. I don't think, it has been, if you go back, the way I compare genomics today is the way we used to see computing at the early stage. If you go back 25 years, we never thought in the cell phone you will get the power which we used to get in mainframe computers spending millions of dollars 25 years back. I think genomics is at that stage, what we call in an exponential curve. And once it hits a sweet spot, it just power goes up exponentially. And I think genomics is standing there. And I think over next two decades or so, genomics will completely change the way healthcare is being done. And I think it's going to play a very, very critical role. And it's going to, and I'll talk about two areas specifically. So this slide talks a little bit about how you can take an omics-based approach in drug safety, right? You talk about, as I talked a little bit about toxicology, and I talked a little bit about it's not enough, I think, to do a lab experiment with rat or mouse. I think toxicogenomics can play a very, very important role. I think combining toxicology and genomics. And I think a lot of cases it can give rise to biomarkers which will appear well before the full adverse event shows up. I think which will be a huge advantage. Pharmacogenomics, I think, can differentiate between people. I think still today we know the way each person metabolizes drugs, etc., vary person to person. And I think, example being, I think you keep hearing about a lot of people cannot transport statins to liver, so it ends up harming their muscles, etc. So I think using this kind of genetic biomarkers, you should be able to, you should be able to come up with companion diagnostics, right? Which also in turn will help you identify the right patients for the drugs. And I think, in many terms, I think genomics is going to be one of the game changer, not only in drug safety, but in overall healthcare scenario. A little bit about information and insights integration. I think there is tremendous amount of structured and unstructured information available today, right? But there is no single place, right? All you have structured data sources which can be used for safety analysis at various places. So you need to have a very strong foundation in terms of bringing all those information together. And when you take it to the unstructured sources, things gets even more complicated, right? Integrating or insight, getting insights out of unstructured sources. Having said that, I think it's easier said than done. I think lack of standard ontology is a very big, very important factor, which stops us from doing many of the things. And I think the skill set you require to integrate structured, unstructured information into knowledge is a very different set of skills than just compiling information. If you take the clinical information side, I think human trials gives you a limited amount of data during the trial phase of the molecule. I think you get a lot of data in the post-marketing phase, and a lot of it is captured in various formats, specifically in the EMR. And getting those EMR data together and integrating can be a huge source for drug safety analysis, right? But the question is lack of policy. I think getting healthcare data around the globe, every country has a different format, every country has a different set of rules and regulations. And second is, I think the summarizing clinical information out of an EMR is not an easy job, right? Clinical symptomatology, which is its linkage to treatment protocol, etc., is underrepresented. And I think you need to interpret a lot of physicians' notes. And I am not a doctor. My father used to be a doctor. Reading doctor's notes are not easy job, right? So it's a very cumbersome process. But those are the things, while there are a lot of information, I think you need to bring in technologies and processes and technology, and the architecture together to make it happen. And I think we are making definitive progress there, but I think there is still a long way to go. If you talk a little bit about analytics, I think searching, it's about information and insights, right? I think information is available at a lot of places. But getting those information together, doing the right kind of analysis, what will give you insights. And I think there are various data sources for information, and we are all aware of it. And I have been part of, I think, limited experiments where we are trying to get many of these kind of data together in a context and trying to do various kind of data minings and advanced analytics. And it can come up with pretty interesting insights and integration. You have a lot of, before I go into the architecture, I think there are a lot of different kinds of statistical techniques, and it's a used for detection, strengthening of drug safety signals, and specific patient population at risk, and the subgroups identification you can do. And I think most of you will be available with this kind of analysis techniques, but I think they are getting more and more used. Clustering, segmentation, link analysis, measurement of disproportionality, predictive modeling, these kind of techniques. And I think bringing those kind of techniques together with data mining can give you deep insights. And that when you combine with, I think, EMR data and healthcare claims data, again, another data source, I think, which has tremendous amount of data, but again, availability of that data in correct format and integrating is always a problem. I think it can give you a lot of strength in terms of proactive safety surveillance, right? But it does require that access to the data, overcoming the regulatory hurdles, as well as bringing them all together in a common format and applying the statistical techniques. So I think if you can do that, I think what is going to be happen is you will have safety analysis which is real time, which is proactive, and which is actionable. I think that is what at the end of the day you want to achieve. Technologies, I think I don't have to talk to anybody about technology. Pretty much technology is part of everyday life. I think it's shifting the architectural paradigms. I think technologies like big data, which used to be an extremely difficult proposition many, a decade back. Now there are dozens of big data technologies available at a very affordable cost. Technologies like high performance computing, which if you go back a decade, was only available to very, very high price to limited set of people. For space research and so on, I think it's now available pretty much in a commodity format. Sophisticated natural language processing technique, while I think we think it has made a lot of progress, I think it is making progress every day, more and more. Data visualization techniques, and finally cloud-based platforms, which I think can do an important cross an important boundary of sharing across organizations. I think all of them will come together for next generation drug safety architecture. I think this is something we are putting together in TCS, a next generation safety architecture using a lot of available off-the-shelf products, as well as a lot of our internal it's not a platform to talk about TCS. We do a lot of work in drug safety process. We have a team in genomics. We have a team which does analysis, and we have a lot of team which, of course, does technologies. So what we are trying to do is bringing all of them together, and then we are working with a couple of our clients to validate and putting the model together to see what kind of next generation advantage we can give to our clients. So having said all of it, let's talk a little bit about, I think, regulatory and benefit risk assessment. I think we touched upon it very briefly during the initial comments. I think, of course, drug approval by regulatory authorities are always based on their assessments of benefits and risk. I think a lot of structured approaches are being used to perform this assessment, both qualitative and quantitative methods. Thorough and transparent, I think, benefit risk assessment is being done. And I think that is the way regulatory direction is going to be. And I think in that context also, all the said I said, it makes it a lot more quantitative, a lot more transparent, a lot more data-driven. And I think it makes your life easier as a drug safety professional when you go to the regulatory authorities. So if putting it all together, I think each of these focus area needs to be carefully woven into a larger plan to ensure that enhanced patient safety is done. Science will continue to be underlying foundation to increase our confidence in drug safety, but I think information and insights integration will actually fill the gap in your safety knowledge. Availability of benefit risk profile covering various clinical scenarios, patient subgroups, personalization will facilitate appropriate risk management practices. I think that is how you have to bring all of this together. You need to look at drug safety as a whole and build your capabilities and collaborations accordingly. So this is what we call our 5i model of next generation drug safety function. It's about integrate, inquire, identify, improve, and inform. It represents different components of the drug safety in the entire life cycle of the drug. We expect that the next generation drug safety function will combine various perspectives needed. It will collaborate with R&D for capturing safety related insights, while it continue to be the custodian of all safety related information. It will perform advanced analytics to identify safety concerns early. It will proactively address safety concerns via risk management practices, and it will finally devise safety communication strategy and perform regulatory interactions. I think both inter-organization and intra-organizations collaborations are required for you to really develop such a next generation drug safety organization. So I think need of the hour is to envisage the future, set some very aspirational yet realistic target, and march your organizations into a next generation drug safety function. Thank you.